In the previous lecture, we started the discussion on the electronics behind different logic gates. And we saw how the basic gates like the AND, the OR, and the NOT can be implemented using diodes and transistors. In particular, AND and OR can be implemented using diodes, and the NOT gate using a bipolar junction transistor. But we saw that in these cases, especially in the case of using diodes, we saw that if the high logic corresponds to 5 volts and the low logic corresponds to 0 volts, or logic 1 corresponds to 5 volts and logic 0 corresponds to 0 volts, we saw that in all the cases we are not getting exact 5 volts or exact 0 volts. Some considerable difference is there. So therefore, often at times what happens is that these are called as strong zeros, strong ones, weak zeros, weak ones. So because of these weak zeros and weak ones, there could be problems in the voltages. It may so happen that the voltage may not be read as a proper one or a proper zero logic. So then, one question that we can ask ourselves is that what is the range of voltages which is considered as 1, and what is the range of voltages which is considered as 0? So therefore, if we say that logic 1 corresponds to 5 volts and logic 0 corresponds to 0 volts, there are different kinds of standards which allow a slight amount of variation. Let us say if you draw an axis of voltage, let us say this is 5 volts and this is 0 volts. Because electronic devices are not ideal, we should always account for some margin of error. So effectively, most logic devices give this margin. And let us say, if 5 volt is considered as logic 1 and 0 volt is considered as logic 0, definitely to some region below 5 volt and some region above 0 volt, they are considered as the variation for logic 1 and logic 0 respectively. So this is logic 1, this is logic 0. So therefore, ideally, this margin should be as small as possible if the electronic devices become more and more ideal. So let us say one way to do that, let us say this is 4.7 volts we can define. So therefore, you are allowing 0.3 volts margin. Let us say I am calling this as 0.2 volts. So therefore, this margin would be 0.2. Right. What we saw was that little better than diode was the bipolar junction transistor in making of the NOT gate, because it gave a strong one and a weak zero, but that weak zero was not as weak as diodes. So this is what is the BJT, or the bipolar junction transistor. So therefore, it looks as though a better candidate than the diode is the transistor. Although we are not yet sure how to proceed further. But something tells us that BJT is a little better, because the weakness is not as much as that of the diodes. The diode gave a weak zero of 0.7 volts, BJT gave a weak zero of 0.5 volts, which is definitely closer to zero. But then we need to think in one more angle. We need to think from the view of a computer. Now, modern day computers have processors inside them. And those processors are extremely powerful. They can do a number of arithmetic operations, logical operations, and different kinds of data operations. So then the question is that how they are able to do so much complex operations and that too so fast. So the question is, how complex of an operator you want to do? If the answer is that you want to do very complex operation, then you need multiple gates. And as we know, gates are essentially made out of diodes or transistors. Forget diodes. Now we know that diodes are a thing of the past as far as logic gates are concerned. But we know that transistor is the way to go. So therefore, you need to make gates using transistors. This is what we have to look at. So the question is that more number of complex operations you want to do, more transistors you need. So therefore, let us say I want to make a chip or a processor. So I have this block of silicon that is given to us. This is called as a silicon wafer. A piece of silicon is given to us. On this surface, we need to put those transistors in a particular fashion so as to do our operations. Now, this silicon is nothing but a piece of real estate. So therefore, if you go to some city where essentially real estate builders have to build an apartment, but the space is very less. But at the same time, they want to build an apartment and each apartment should be able to hold many, many people, or it should have many rooms. So therefore, they have to do it optimally. So given the same area, if you want to put more number of rooms, the size of each room has to reduce. So therefore, if I want to put more and more number of transistors, the size of each transistor has to reduce. Now suppose, generally what happens is that silicon wafers normally come in the dimensions of millimeters. So let us say I'm giving you a 2x2 square millimeter of silicon area. The question is, how many transistors can you fit over there? Well, in the 1970s, the technology was not very developed. This piece of silicon could hold about 50 transistors. In the 1970s, this could hold only about 50 transistors. That may sound like a lot, but actually it isn't. In the 1980s, as technology improved, they could hold about 1,000 transistors. In the 1990s, this number increased 100,000. In the 2000s, this increased to 1,000,000. And in the 2010s, this further increased to more than 10,000,000. The question now is that within a span of 40 years, how did we go from being able to fit 50 transistors all the way to 10 million. This is how much? This is 10 million. How did this growth happen? This happened because we made transistors smaller and smaller. In the early days, people started with the bipolar transistor and they started making it smaller and smaller. But they saw that beyond the point, it's useless. Because there are a lot of these parameters of the transistor like beta and the current handling capacity. That was sort of not showing any improvement. Naturally, as we tried to increase the number of transistors, the power requirements on the chip would also become very, very large. More number of transistors would mean more current. So therefore, the transistors should be handled in such a way that we should not just reduce their size without thinking, but we should reduce the size in such a way that we are able to minimize any additional power requirement. So therefore, it was seen that this bipolar junction transistor was not of much use beyond a certain point of reducing the size. So therefore, the answer came into this device called as a MOSFET. This is called metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. It is still a transistor, but it is quite different from the BJT, which is a bipolar junction transistor. So, let us see how the MOSFET is different from the BJT. So, the things about the MOSFET, the unique features is that unlike BJT, it is a voltage controlled device. Remember that the bipolar junction transistor or the BJT is a current control transistor. That means the collector current depends on the base current. Here, that is not the case. Here, there is some current which depends on some voltage, not current. So, the second point about the MOSFET is that it is a unipolar device. This is opposite of bipolar. Unipolar means that the current exists because of only one type of carrier, either electrons or holes. In the bipolar transistor, the current depends on both type of carriers, not just one. But in the MOSFET, the current depends on only one type of carriers, either electrons or either holes, but not both. So, although you may have learned a little bit about the MOSFET in your basic circuits courses, let us very quickly take a look at the MOSFET once again. So essentially, if you recall, your bipolar junction transistor has three terminals, an emitter, a base, and a collector. However, the MOSFET has four terminals. The MOSFET has four terminals. A drain, gate, source, and body. out of which the drain and source many a times can be interchanged. So they are identical, in fact. But we call them drain and source because essentially they play a role in which the current essentially flows. But structure wise, they are the same. So essentially, they can be interchanged. And the MOSFET is a symmetrical device. So effectively, it looks something like this. So just like how a bipolar junction transistor is of two types, NPN or a PNP, MOSFET also is of two types, an N-type MOSFET or a P-type MOSFET. So one is called as NMOS, the other is called as a PMOS. This is an N-type MOSFET. And this is a P-type MOS. Okay, so essentially, the NMOS, the body is of P-type. And in PMOS, the body is N-type. Over here, there are two semiconductor layers. Those are N-type. Here also, there are two semiconductor layers. Like this, you can call them as kind of wells. These are of P-type. This terminal is called as the body terminal, which is this. The substrate is also called as the body. Then, between these two, there exists essentially two layers, one which are in a vertical sense, one over here, the other over here. So this one I'm going to shade. Likewise, same over here. The nice thing, the thing to note over here is that the top layer is called a metal layer. And this one, which is shaded, is essentially an insulator, which is nothing but silicon dioxide. So if you look vertically, you have a metal, you have an oxide, and then you have this P-type semiconductor. Same over here. That is why the name MOS comes, metal oxide semiconductor. And this terminal is called as the gate. This is also the gate. So therefore, these two, they are identical. These terminals are called as the source and the drain. Likewise, this is source, this is drain. Okay, so essentially you can make this into a 3D structure which can look like this, something of this kind. You can have layers like this which go this way. This essentially becomes a rectangular structure. But we'll not discuss that so much. Effectively, all of these are 3D structures, but we will look at them in a 2D form. So, now, first thing to note is that this body must be 0 volts for NMOS, right? And this has to be logic 1 for PMOS. So let us say it's 5 volts. So these voltages are always fixed. These voltages are always fixed. So there's a reason why they are fixed. It is to avoid certain kind of bad effects. Now, what those effects are, that's beyond the scope of this course. So therefore, often what happens is that although this body is there, since these voltages are fixed, we normally don't show them often when we are drawing the symbols. So the symbol for the NMOS looks like this. This is the drain, source gate. And for the PMOS, it looks like this. Drain, source, but the gate, there is a bubble. Kind of like a NOT gate. But don't hold me to it. This is not a NOT gate. It just means that there is something different about the PMOS as compared to the NMOS. Obviously, there has to be some difference, because without that, there is no point. Now, since there are two kinds of MOSFETs, NMOS and PMOS, we will look at only one kind of MOSFET in little bit detail, and then we shall move over and assume that just the opposite happens for the case of the other. So therefore, let us look at the NMOS. So let us draw what it looks like. The source and the drain. The body, as we know, is always ground. Now, let us start with a very simple case. Let us assume that the source and the drain, they are both connected to ground. So we'll say assume VD equals VS equals 0. That is the drain and source voltage are essentially zero. These are of N type and this is of P type. This is the gate. So now let's suppose we have this gate with us whose voltage we can change or whose voltage we can control. So suppose we say case 1 is that the gate voltage is less than or equal to 0. Then what would happen? If the gate voltage is negative, the p-type substrate or the p-type semiconductor will have holes as carriers. So those holes will essentially start being drawn to the gate side. This is what it will look like. This is what it will look like. But then this is not of any use, because the N-type regions on either side of this area, they have electrons. The question now is that, can we form a bridge somehow between the source and the drain? Now to form a bridge, we will need a bridge of electrons, because holes and electrons are opposing type of charge carriers, and therefore you cannot sort of move them between here and there. So therefore, suppose we now make VG as more than 0. Now what? If I make VG more than 0, this becomes positive. So therefore, these holes which were earlier over here will now be pushed back, because like charges will repel opposing fields. These holes will start moving downwards away from this region. So it seems that now that these holes are moving away, the region that is immediately below the gate inside the semiconductor, there will essentially be no charge. But the catch is, p-type semiconductors has holes in majority, but does it mean that it has zero electrons? No, the electrons are there, but in minority. It is not zero. To maintain the equilibrium, there have to be some electrons. So therefore, there are electrons. So therefore, the question now is that can we do something where those electrons in the p-type body, but small in number, can we pull them towards the gate? So in that case, this gate voltage has to be sufficiently high. So therefore, we say that for this to happen, the gate voltage needs to be above a certain voltage, and that is called as a threshold voltage. Threshold voltage of the transistor. So the moment you have the gate voltage, which is essentially more than the threshold voltage, what happens? The holes essentially move down. And in this case, what you will see is that the electrons will start accumulating over here. Now, something very interesting is happening. This is a p-type body. And these two layers are n-type, but even within even within the p-type region, very close to the gate, you will have a large number of electrons which will accumulate. Even though it's a p-type region, you expect to see that there will be more holes, but very close to the gate you have this large number of electrons which have accumulated. So therefore, this phenomena is called as inversion phenomena. Where you have the opposite. The electrons are there more in number, where ideally you would expect to see more holes. Okay, so now what has happened? Now you can see that normally these n-type drain and source layers would have electrons, and here also making a bridge between them are these electrons. So therefore now a bridge has been formed. So therefore if we are careful enough, we can actually send electrons from here to here or here to here, doesn't matter, they are symmetric. So therefore, the question now is, how do we do this? How can we move the electrons from one side to another side, or between the drain and the source? First thing is, the gate voltage has to be more than the threshold voltage. So, coming back, we have the body at ground, source, drain, this is the oxide, so let us say Vg is now quite high, let us say much more than the threshold. So now, let us say the source is grounded, but we give some voltage over here, some DC voltage at the drain. Let me call this as Vd. Of course, Vs is 0. So now what will happen? Electrons were over here, they are over here, here and here. So because of this positive voltage over here, the field will essentially cause these electrons to sort of move this way from the source to the drain. Now there are multiple things which are happening. The gate voltage is causing the electrons to accumulate over here. But notice that there is no direct connection between the gate and the p-type body. There is no direct connection. There is an oxide layer in the middle which is acting like an insulator. So therefore, these electrons are attracted purely by means of the field. So therefore, it is called as a field effect transistor. Furthermore, the number of electrons which are accumulating, this depends on the gate voltage. Therefore, this is a voltage controlled transistor. There is absolutely no concept of any current at the gate because there's an insulator. There's only voltage which creates an electric field which attracts the electrons. So therefore, if Vd is more than 0, I can slowly start pulling them over here. I can slowly start pulling the electrons over here. So therefore, this is the drain, this is the gate, this is the source. So if this is the source, this is the drain. The electrons are essentially moving from the source to the drain. But we can assign a current over here, and the current is nothing but the direction of which is opposite to the flow of electrons. So therefore, I will call this as a drain current ID. So this ID is there. And this is the current which is essentially controlled by the gate voltage Vg. Okay? So, the bridge which essentially is formed between these two points is called as a channel. So, the more you increase the drain voltage, more number of electrons you can pull towards itself. So, the drain current will increase even more. So, if one thing we can say, let us say, if Vs is fixed, then I can say, if Vg increases, then Id will increase. And we expect, say, if Vs is fixed, but we increase Vd, even then, the Id should increase. Right? So therefore, let us try to draw this in the form of a graph. Let us say this is Id and this is Vg. Suppose I make Vd as fixed to some positive value. So if Vg is essentially 0, the Id will be 0 because as we know, the electrons will not be pulled. So therefore, we know that Vg has to exceed Vth. So below that, it will be 0. Now, as we increase the Vg, more and more number of electrons will be pulled towards it. And therefore, the current is expected to increase in a linear fashion. This is assuming fixed Vds. So therefore, this is also called as the linear region of operation or linear regime operation. Okay. So over here, the drain current is essentially a linear function of the gate voltage. So in general, Vs is often not fixed. Here we took Vs as 0, just to make things simple. So generally, if we say that Vs is not fixed, then what we do is we measure the gate voltage and the drain voltage with respect to the source voltage. So we will now define two quantities. One is called as VGS, which is nothing but VG minus VS. The other is VDS, or the drain to source voltage, which is VD minus VS. So even in case VS is not fixed, the same will follow, but except this graph will now be a function of VGS. There's absolutely no difference. So because we are sort of using the source terminal as a reference voltage. Now, the drain current in the linear regime of operation can be represented in this format. Kn is a constant times. It is a linear function of VGS, but not linear function of VDS. So this Kn is a constant that depends on the transistor. This Kn is actually this mu n C aux times W by L. Now what are these? So as you know, the MOSFET looks like this. This is the gate. This is called the length of the channel L. Whereas, if you look at the 3D view of the gate or the transistor, this will look like some kind of a rectangle. This is called as W. W is the width of the gate, length is the, or L is the length of the gate. C aux is the capacitance that is formed by this silicon dioxide. The C aux is the capacitance that is formed by the insulator. And mu n is the mobility of electrons. So therefore, once again, you can see that this ID, or the drain current, which essentially flows from the drain to the source, is a linear function of VGS, or a first order function of VGS, and it is some kind of a quadratic function of VDS. Okay. So this will only work, obviously, if the gate to source voltage is more than the threshold voltage. Again, earlier I was saying VG more than VTH, but now I can say VGS is more than VTH because I'm using the source terminal as a point of reference. So now let us see how ID changes as a function of VDS. So let us try to draw a graph of ID as a function of VDS, assuming that VGS is some fixed value which is more than VTH. Because if this is not met, there will be no current. So if this condition is not met, no matter how large is the VDS or the drain potential, the current will never ever flow because the bridge itself will not be formed. So if I try to plot this graph, this is a constant, some positive constant, times VDS minus half VDS square. What we will essentially see is that this will be a kind of convex graph. And it will reach a maximum when? You can find out the maximum point by differentiating ID with respect to VDS and essentially make it 0. If you do that, you will see that when VDS equals VGS minus VTH, the maxima will be reached. VGS minus VTH. So after that, what will happen? After that, it would reduce because we are saying this is the maximum. But actually, that doesn't happen. Actually, that doesn't happen. A very, very interesting phenomenon happens. Now, if the drain voltage or the voltage at the drain essentially increases, what happens is that for the same gate voltage, the drain voltage is increasing, whereas the source voltage is fixed. So the more this voltage increases, this structure sort of loses its symmetry from the purview of voltage. Between the gate and the source, the voltage difference is more. You can assume Vs is zero for the time. If Vd essentially increases, the difference in voltage between these two terminals reduces. So effectively what is happening is that the electric field between the gate and source is more, and the electric field between the gate and the drain is less. So more number of electrons will be here and less number of electrons will be here. The bridge will be essentially thicker over here and thinner over here. So it's like saying the channel will look like this. Now, if you keep increasing the VD, a point will come when the difference between VG and VD will fall below the threshold voltage, and that is this point. So effectively, if you increase the drain voltage, this side will not change because source voltage is fixed. This side essentially becomes so and so narrow that the bridge will essentially kind of close down. This phenomena is called as pinch off. Now after that, if you increase VD anymore, you will see that the current will not change. The current essentially will be fixed because these carriers have to go somewhere. So they will shoot through, but they will not increase in number. More and more carriers will start accumulating, but only fixed number can cross through. It's like saying that you have a road, part of which is blocked. There's only one channel left. So therefore only one car can pass through. So therefore, beyond this point, the current essentially becomes constant. So this is called as the saturation region or saturation regime. Whereas this part before the pinch off is called as the linear regime. This equation is valid only for linear regime. But for saturation, this is not correct. In case of saturation, all you need to do is substitute VDS equal to VGS minus VTH and you will get the correct. So that is nothing but KN by 2 in saturation times VGS minus VTH the whole square. This is for the saturation. So in this particular lecture, we discussed the basic working principle of the MOSFET, which should ideally be a revision from your basic circuits course. We saw that the MOSFET is used because the bipolar transistor has certain disadvantages which prevent it from being made so small in size that we can fit thousands and millions of transistors on a single piece of silicon. So effectively, as we will see in the next lecture, using the MOSFET, we can essentially build up various kinds of logic gates. And this MOSFET forms the building block of most modern day logic circuits. And that is what we shall discuss in the next lecture. Thank you.